Hey everybody, I am joined here with Esoteric Entity, someone that you might have known. I've referenced him in quite a few of my videos. We've had some disputes online over various issues, you know, we've had various disagreements on things, and I thought we would communicate, have a conversation, have a discourse, talk about it. Esoteric Entity's channel, though, has been suspended, I believe, so you can go check him out at his second channel, which I believe is also called Esoteric Entity. But yeah, I appreciate you coming on, man, to speak to me.
Oh yeah, it's no problem. I'd be glad to come on any show, really.
Cool. So I'm not really prepared for this in the sense that I don't really have any topic or something that we're going to, like, debate on. But of course we have disagreements that we can just talk about. And so firstly, I guess I wanted to address something you had said in one of your videos, sir.
Well, that's good because, yeah, I didn't prepare for this one like I did my Michelle Caitlin debate.
All right, no worries. So the first thing I wanted to address, I guess, was something you had said in one of your videos. Now, I made a response to it at the time. However, I thought it would be more productive to just, I guess, ask you in person. And that is regarding your video on Keynes. And I guess you probably know where I'm going with this.
Conflating supply and demand side. I disagree with both of them, but I didn't understand the difference, and that was stupid. So.
Okay. Oh, well, I'm glad you're honest about that. But what do you mean you disagree with both supply side and demand side? Do you reject supply and demand as a model?
No, what I reject is a government program to try and stimulate either the supply or demand side. I tend to fall into the Say's Law camp or something generally related to that.
Okay.
Because that's my problem with supply side as well. Is that stimulus packages and stuff like that are also bad for the economy.
Okay. So you would say that you are supply side because you believe that an increase in the supply or a shift in the aggregate supply curve will overall increase productivity and not just increase the price level, but you would just say that the government isn't an effective agent in affecting supply. Supply must be changed by entrepreneurs and economic agents within the economy rather than the centralized third party.
Well, I wouldn't necessarily say that raising supply is always going to result in economic growth, and that's all. And that's another big part of my issue with supply side is that's you can also get bubbles that way, which is not a good thing.
Okay. But you said you believe in Say's Law as well, which essentially states that.
Well, yeah, I tend to fall into that camp I just don't really have a policy regarding that.
Because if you take the Austrian school, they are unanimously supply-side economists. Every single one of them believes in Say's Law, from Eugen von Bombowerk, Murray Rothbard, Ludwig von Mises. They believe that, as the classical view goes, that we produce because we supply, and that this Keynesian revolt against the classical ways of conducting economics by saying that it is demand that increases production.
That's wrong. What you mean by supply side. No, I was thinking you were talking about something entirely different, like the neoclassical approach to supply side. No, I get what you're saying. So I suppose if that's how we're looking at it, then
okay.
Yeah.
But that's just how it's looked at in orthodox economics. Because when you study economics, you're not always just looking for an excuse to talk about politics. It's also just something to study for its own sake. And we want to look at what actors are the ones that increase production. Is it consumers?
Oh, yeah, I know.
Yeah, okay.
I know. My interest in economics has nothing to do with my political views. I just... I don't think that government programs to stimulate supply are good for the economy. Same thing with demand, which is why I...
Sure. And my point earlier about all the Austrians in history was that they would all be supply-side economists, but would say the government is an effective means of actually shifting the supply curve, and their efforts are futile. Of course, people disagree with that, but if you're sticking to the conventional Austrian school of thought, that would be an example of supply-side economists that also don't believe the government has any job or any place in intervening into the market. So would you say you would correspond more with a view like that?
Yeah, that sounds more like where I'm at.
Okay, sure. And just to nail in my point and bring it home, that is nonetheless a supply-side school of thought. So you would say you are supply-side?
Yeah, that sounds about right. I don't know if I just had a misunderstanding of what supply-side was, but I understood it just based on what people who are statists advocate for in supply side, and I thought that's sort of what supply side was. It was raise supply, because raising supply will boost aggregate demand. And
yeah, because if you take like an economics degree, like you do a Bachelor of Economics, these questions about old school economic theory, even as far back as something which seems kind of recent, such as Keynes, where we're talking about Say's law and supply side versus demand side, these things are kind of taken for granted. And if you ask any econ major, they probably wouldn't know whether they are supply side or demand side, because it isn't something you actually learn. It's actually fairly niche as a subject matter. So yeah, I'm sure it's something that is kind of unheard of.
That's why I'd specify that I support Say's law, because when you say supply side, that sort of that also implies government stimulus programs, but Say's law, when you say that Say's law, that does not imply that. It just...
All right, well, so. Yeah, okay, I feel like people will understand where you're coming from with this. Now, secondly, I made a video on logic. This is the second thing I wanted to get into. I introduced first-order logic with identity, including its most basic language, as well as truth tables, and I also talked about the underlying premise of predicate logic and why it exists. I didn't really go into using the language of predicate logic that much, but I explained how it expands upon classical logic and the need for predicate logic. And I know you have some disputes with this. You even said at one point you were going to make a response video to my video on logic, but something I wanted you to explain was the comment you left on my video, which is no longer there because, again, your channel has been suspended. And it went along the lines of, biggest problem with this video, it confuses logic with rationalization or something like that. That's what I remember it to be. But I was just wondering, what do you mean by that comment? And secondly, or more generally, what was wrong with my video on logic?
Well, the difference between rationalizing something and logic is that when referring to propositional logic, mathematics, there's a mathematical basis in propositional logic, and that can be expressed actually from an observational objective formula. For example, in the case of a binary example like theft, for instance, P and negative P. And there will always be one value specifically and not the other value. Because the tilde and ampersand operators have the same standard value table assignments. So
like you're putting forward an Aristotelian understanding of truth. Things are true or false, and there's no in-between muddy thing. Is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah, essentially, what I'm getting to is that it's possible to quantify something that is objectively correct from observation, from a scientific formula, and that's what I mean, is that it's possible to rationalize something which cannot be objectively observed. And because you can rationalize something which is not objectively observable, that does not necessarily mean that there is not an objective basis in reality for what is right and wrong.
Are you talking about the existence of a priori knowledge when you say that you can rationalize to something that's not? Okay.
Yes, sure, I am.
Now, when we talk about logic, though, and I would dispute that as somebody that is an operationalist, as somebody that believes that logic alone, which is simply a means of testing internal consistency, is not sufficient for truthhood, because all logic is essentially, you said it was mathematical, I think a better word would be systematic, in that it is a systematic means of manipulating terms without actually seeing where those terms have risen from or seeing where those terms actually come from in the first place. It's simply, and this is something you would learn in a logic textbook, it's a way of testing internal consistency, which is to say that all logic is a means of testing validity, and the actual way the propositions in a logical argument comport to reality is something that isn't determined by classical logic alone. So the question I would have is, how does internal consistency alone arrive one at a position of truthhood?
How does internal consistency arrive from a position of truthhood?
Yeah.
I don't necessarily understand what you're asking there.
So logic tests internal consistency. It makes sure that propositions follow from each other, but it tells you nothing about the actual content of those propositions. It only tests validity, and the validity of an argument is determined solely by its structure, not the actual claims that it is making about the world. So how can the structure of an argument, its internal consistency, or its validity, all three things being synonymous, arrive one at a position of truthhood?
Well, it's because, as I touched upon earlier, there are objective conclusions which can be reached when thinking about a scenario. For example, would theft be justified? Well, no, because the individual has self-ownership, and the individual uses their self-ownership to create their property, and therefore that property is an extension of the individual's self-ownership, and to violate that, you would have to be setting a double standard for yourself, because you're not entitled to that since you did not produce
yeah,
it.
Let me give you an example so what I'm talking about. Take this argument. This is a chain of propositions which are intended to lead one to a conclusion, and hence it is an argument, and it goes like this. If grass is green, then aliens exist. Grass is green, therefore aliens exist. That is a perfectly valid, internally consistent argument, which in virtue of its structure makes the propositions lead you to the conclusion completely perfectly. But you and I both know this is a false argument. So
it's a non sequitur, yeah.
It's not a non sequitur. It's a perfect sequitur. It's just that it's not sound.
Yeah, grass is green, therefore aliens exist. The aliens existing has nothing to do with the premise, and therefore it's a non sequitur.
It's not a non sequitur if we talk about classical logic, because the proposition can't have any properties using classical logic. In the Aristotelian first order logical world, there's no properties.
But we're not talking about the history of logic. We're talking about just simply what it is. And
yeah, and I'm telling you that classical logic doesn't assign properties to propositions, and thus it's if A then B, B therefore A. That is a perfectly valid argument if you're looking at its structure, which in classical logic
As a matter of fact, that's a fallacious line of reasoning known as affirming the consequent.
No, it's not. I do know what that fallacy is. But if A, therefore B, A, therefore B, which is what I meant to say, I misspoke. If grass is green, then aliens exist. The grass is green, therefore aliens exist. In other words, if A, then B, A, therefore B. That is not a fallacy. That is a perfectly valid argument. But you and I know it is false, despite it being internally consistent, because the propositions within that argument are not true. And I'm saying if internal consistency is sufficient for truthhood, then how can the existence of such an argument that is false exist in this world?
Well, simply it can't, and I'll give you another good example of that. Merely saying that logic is subjective is itself an internally contradictory statement, because if you're claiming that logic is not objective, and you're claiming that logic is subjective, that means that you believe in a degree of objective logistics, because you believe that
I don't logic believe logic is subjective.
Yeah, and that's a nonsensical statement that...
Yeah, it is. I don't believe logic is subjective, but like...
Yeah, you don't believe logic is objective. You're expressing...
No, I don't...
Making that statement.
Yeah, I don't believe logic is subjective. I believe logic is objective.
Oh. I thought you said it wasn't. I wasn't understanding there.
So what I'm arguing, though, is that logic in and of itself, as a construct that we have made to see how truth distributes itself across different propositions in order to test the consistency of a sequence of these propositions, aka an argument, is insufficient to arrive one at truthhood. What it is sufficient for is to derive a hypothesis, which then needs a degree of measurement and empirical conduction to actually arrive at falsification and Karl Popper and these sorts of things. But what I am arguing is that internal consistency in itself is insufficient, and I'm asking you, I've put forward an argument that I believe is a counterexample to the claim that internal consistency is sufficient for truthhood, and I'm asking you how to coincide the existence of this argument with your view.
Wait, you're asking me a question, or were you just explaining your point?
Both. So, like, the argument, if A...
Yeah, your yish-gal thing a little bit, so I didn't even really understand you were asking me a question.
Okay, I can re-explain. So take this argument, I'll just give you it in terms of its structure and tell me if this is valid. If A, therefore B. A, therefore B. So if A is true, B is also true. A is true, so B must also be true.
Yeah, that's not a valid line of reasoning, because B and A are two separate things, and the proof of one being correct does not mean that the other is correct.
No, that is perfectly valid. That's affirming the antecedent. That is a perfectly valid argument. That's not a logical fallacy.
No, if you Google not a logical fallacy. You're taking one, you're saying that one is correct, and therefore the other has to be correct because one is correct.
Yeah, it's because validity is only one half of a good argument. It also must be sound. So look, if you just Google affirming the antecedent, this is taught at a university level consistently and in high school philosophy classes. It is a clear-cut example of a valid argument. So for a similar case would be all men are mortal, Socrates is a man, therefore Socrates is mortal. This is some way of affirming the antecedent. There is debate over that, actually, but... for the sake of this argument, that would be an example of a perfectly valid argument that is taught in philosophy classes.
So you didn't explain that very well. I suppose in certain examples, it could be a valid argument. So it's one of those, like, it can be valid, but it also, there are some cases where it's not a valid line of reasoning. Apples are fruits. And cars are red like apples, therefore cars are fruits. That could also be made with that line of reasoning, and that's
I don't believe it could. I don't believe that was the same argument. Yeah, I don't believe you could rearrange that argument to be structured like that. But the point that I'm making is that arguments are valid in terms of their structure. When you say an argument is valid, you're making a claim about that argument's structure. And what that claim is that the conclusion necessarily follows from the premises. If the premises are true, the conclusion has to be true. It is truth-preserving, some would say. But if those premises aren't true, and the conclusion is therefore false because of that, that argument doesn't cease to be valid. Instead, it is still valid, but it is just not sound. The second requirement for a good argument. And that is what I'm trying to convey to you. But if you are saying that an argument...
It's not objective, then.
Okay, sure. But the point being that if you are saying that you can arrive at truth using internal consistency alone, an a priori truth, then how is it something can be true if all you're testing for is validity and you're not using any empirical observations to actually prove that these propositions are true? I was going to say, unless you are to argue that these premises are self-evident, which is a common route people take, but I don't really buy that. And I guess this is more of a dispute over praxeology than it is your argument for the non-aggression principle.
Well, no, it's not necessarily self-evident, because obviously people come to different conclusions, but the fact of the matter is that there is a correct conclusion.
Okay, sure, there is a correct conclusion.
That's all that I'm arguing, is that there's a correct conclusion, and therefore there is an objective way that people can observe it and people can realize it.
Okay, sure. There's an objective truth. There's a truth out there. There is now, generally, is that what you're arguing? That there's a reality indistinguishable and separate from you and I and our minds that is real and independent of our thoughts about it?
Yeah, and generally how individualist societies would realize this in the past, or stateless individualist societies, they would establish a common law based on these conclusions, such as ancient Ireland's Brehon Law would be an example of this. It's basically the oldest preserved example. You got some other examples like Cuss Fire, but...
Yeah, I listened to the Tom Woods podcast on that case study some time ago, which was fairly interesting.
Yeah, so... And that's simply all I'm saying, is that because there is an objective conclusion that can be realized, and there are ways which can be used to refute false conclusions, that means it's possible to establish a stateless common law, which is the biggest realization from the idea that logic is objective, is that law does not require the existence of an arbiter.
That is something disagree on. We can probably have this discussion congregating around another discussion that I wanted to bring up as well. I won't push you any more on this logic thing. I think people at home will understand your position on it. I wanted to turn to your disagreement with Hoppe and even Rothbard to an extent, or just generally your disagreements with the paleo-libertarian crowd. Now, I'm personally not the strictest follower of either of these authors, but I think your disagreement with them brings up a greater discourse that I would like to have with you, because I feel as if this will be kind of like a son of ice colliding with a son of fire, and I guess that discourse relates to an existential...
Just to provide some perspective of where I'm at, I fall into the, on economics, I tend to fall into the Konkin category. You know Samuel Edward Konkin, right?
Yeah, I'm familiar with him.
And on a social standpoint, I tend to side with Lysander Spooner. So, not a paleo-libertarian, and I'm just strict individualist.
Right, and so that's very... old school in some ways, because the discourse in America, at least, has kind of suffered an existential realization in the last 50 years. And, so there's been a transition that is in the libertarian thought bubble in the United States from an extremely antisocial individualism to a, as Hoppe would describe it, a radical brand of conservatism. And I think a good way to explain this would be to reference a criticism of capitalism actually made from the right, and that being a criticism put forward in Julius Evola's Ride the Tiger, which is a great book that I read late last year, and I'll definitely recommend it. And I'll explain what I mean. Evola essentially posits that capitalism has a dialectic relationship with communism, and that the proponents of both ideologies see the tragedy of the modern world and the chaos that man has embraced with his own undoing of the chains of tradition, and excuse the esoteric language, I guess this is just a lot of the way these ideas are written. But however, they have misdiagnosed and thus reduced this existential suffering to strictly economic terms, to something material and something that is not transcendent. And capitalism has promised a comfortable existence, a prosperous life in which the principle of struggle is alleviated from man, and along with it, the law of the old world that sustained him. Yet Marx and Engels, their only criticism of this is that such a plentiful and easy existence is too exclusive, and that it should be extended from the bourgeois exploiters of the upper class to everybody. And for this reason, Evola says that capitalism and communism have a dialectical relationship. They are both disguised nihilism. And now, I don't necessarily agree with this criticism, obviously. I believe in capitalism, and I talk about it on my channel a lot, and I can get into the reasons I disagree with that. But, you know, I think the realization that Evola has is something realized as well, only if more tacitly, by Rothbard and to a greater extent by Hoppe, and that is the value of traditionalism, perhaps firstly as an instrumental means of sustaining a libertarian society, which is something we can also talk about, but ultimately libertarian traditionalism is justified for the same reason as any other tradition, and that is to escape from the cold grasp of nihilism. Now, I guess the question is to end that spiel is, how do you tackle nihilism in your worldview? How does a voluntarist society that is not conservative impose law on itself? If there is nothing above man for him to reach upwards to, how does man draw law for himself from within? And I guess that is my question. And you said, you touched on earlier about how there's no arbiter needed for law, but if law is an abstract concept in and of itself, how can an abstract concept rule anybody? Ultimately, it will be men that rule and bring this abstract concept to life through the through the use of violence, through the use of enforcement. So,
yeah, there are, there's multiple different answers for this question, but I got to be completely honest. This is a part of the debate I am not prepared for.
Okay, we can if you're not comfortable, we don't have to talk about. We can talk about something else.
Yeah, because I've just started getting into that, and I've not like looked into any of it. I've mostly just been into economics and explaining that so far.
Okay, well, how about this? How about when it comes to Hoppeanism? I know you debated Voltaire. I didn't watch that debate, but I saw from the comments that I read that a lot of the disagreement was over this idea of covenant communities. And now I'm an ex-Hoppean, I would say. I'm a Hoppean in the sense that I derive ethics from property rights, and or even though I'm much more analytical than Hoppe does, and I define property differently to him, and I'm not a praxeologist in my economic methodology. And so Hoppe himself might not call me a Hoppean, but I still quite like him. And I am not an ANCAP either in that sense. So
all I can say about justice and a stateless society is that it's based more on compensation than punishment, because that's one of the things you can organize. You can organize through contracts or whatnot.
Do you ever read about the problems of existentialism, like Friedrich Nietzsche, as I mentioned before, Julius Evola, who I'm sure you wouldn't be very fond of as a critic of...
Yeah, not very extensively, no.
Okay, well, a lot of those issues I brought up were more problems of the soul, so to speak, problems about the good life and value and being able to have an upscaling and upwards trajectory in reaching towards something better. And I guess a lot of those questions are very niche and very esoteric and very philosophical. So would you be interested in talking about the idea of Hoppean covenant communities and how you disagree with that?
Well, sure.
Which I will put forward is something separate to the issue that I just asked you about, so we can talk about this.
My main disagreement with Hoppean covenant communities is that, I explained it pretty well in the debate that I had with Voltaire, and that is that the idea of interim property ownerships is a huge problem for me. So, for example, if someone were to build a private town, and they would have to do it, they would have to build it from the ground up in order for it to be truly voluntary. So, or otherwise, everyone in the town would have to be a voluntary participant. The reason for this to be the case is because if you were to build a private city or a private community around property owners already existing, and then you handed them a private law on how things are going to go on your property, and one of them disagrees, well, then either you have to leave or you would have to coerce them out, and at which case that's not voluntary, that's coercive.
Okay, but like, you believe in the freedom of association, right?
Yeah, I do.
Okay, that is to say that people can use their liberty to come together and join groups. And
exactly, I do not have a problem with that.
And in addition to that, those groups can use contractual power so that their members have some obligations that they put on themselves voluntarily through signing those contracts, right?
What do you mean by that specifically?
So, like, they give them a literal piece of paper which says, if you sign this contract, then you owe us maybe this much money for a year to fund this group. That's an example off the top of my head, a hypothetical. It could be anything.
Perhaps, yeah, sure.
And they can sign that contract, and then if that money is not paid, then that is an obligation that they have not fulfilled, and thus there could be some punishment, yeah, some consequence for not doing so. Okay.
then that's an initiation of force because that's fraudulent. So.
Yeah, okay. So what would be the problem with, say, 100 people contractually agreeing to bound their territories that they all own by some collective, some law and order that is enforced by the greater group?
The greater group, you mean
like
property owners getting together?
Yeah, the property owners that have gotten together and contractually agreed. And this is in the Hoppean framework, because Hoppe is an abider of the non-aggression principle and doesn't believe that violence is ever justified and in a strictly normative sense. And thus, he puts forward the idea of the Hoppean covenant community through the lens of a great contractual construct, so to speak, where everybody gets together and signs this contract. Now, you can argue about the effectiveness of this, which I do myself. Like, what about when these people have children and those children don't want to sign the contract, and maybe that could be a criticism,
yeah, so
that it's a short-run thing.
So you agree to join a private community. So basically what you're asking is, if somebody agrees to join a private community, and then that, and they follow the rules of that private community, and that's what they agree to, and then that private community goes on to merge with other private communities and form a contractual law that none of those people have a say in. Yeah, I have a problem with that.
Of course, but that's not what I'm arguing. I'm saying if it is all constructed through the lens of contractual agreement, do you have a problem with it?
So what do you mean by constructed through the lens of contractual agreement, if that's not what you're referring to?
As in, the group that enforces the conservative social order enforces it on the subjects, the citizenry, or whatever you want to call it, because those very citizens and those very same subjects have contractually agreed to be a part of this social order.
Oh, if you're going into that private community and they enforce that sort of stuff onto you, no, there's not really anything wrong with that.
Yeah, because I have heard you. I have heard you defend the idea of a voluntary communist commune in an anarcho-capitalist society. And would you not also, by the same standard, be able to defend a conservative commune?
Yeah.
All right. So you can kind of think of Hoppe in contrast to the voluntary communist commune in an anarcho-capitalist society. On the other hand, Hoppe is simply the conservative who wants a conservative social order that is voluntarily constructed in a libertarian society.
Well, I've looked, and that seems to be the general Hoppean view, but I've looked at things and I found things within his writing, like interim property ownership, and that's, and the lines of these contracts being blurred when private communities decide to do things with, like, other communities, and that's, sort of goes into social contract territory at that point, and, that's,
right.
It's just the social contract with, you know, they're actually being a literal contract.
Yeah, but like, what is wrong with a social contract if it is a literal contract? Because the whole point of social contract theory, which is something that I don't subscribe to myself, is that it is not a physical contract. Instead, it is a tacit one that you sign implicitly without your knowledge, and this contract is disagreed upon on what its actual contents are unanimously across everyone that believes in it.
Well, that's one criticism of it, and that's part of the problem. But the other part of the problem is that if you don't have the ability to actually withdraw your consent, then the contract can't be considered truly voluntary, or you don't have a say in signing it to begin with. And that's the main problems with Hoppe's ideas. He doesn't realize that if you sign a contract with someone and then that person goes on to do things in your name that you didn't consent to, then you're still initiating force against that person.
But that's not universally true, because it's often that you sign a contract in which the terms of the contract is that you cannot withdraw consent for a certain period of time. For instance, with a gym membership or something. And also, there might be terms...
When I mean Okay, I see what you mean. And what I mean by withdraw consent is like if somebody offers it to you, you can say no. That's what I meant by that.
Okay, but also in addition, certain firms often have in their contracts or in their terms that the participant, the person signing the contract, not only cannot withdraw their consent for a certain amount of time, but that they have the leeway to change their terms within a very set of limitations over the course of time as different things happen. Like with iTunes, for instance, that's something that happens
Well,
all
if
the
you
time.
agree to it, then that's another thing. But if
Okay.
you're
Okay. But it sounds like you might not have a conservative mind, you might not share conservative values, and you might not want to live a traditional life. But in
No,
principle, you
I
have
just want my house and I want to live. I'm essentially an unironic atomist, like borderline.
Sure, but like my point being that in principle, although you might not find the Hoppe and ANCAP community desirable, you still would permit it to exist ethically and in accordance with your own moral framework.
If it was actually voluntary and you got some of the rough edges,
Okay, but I'll say something that even more specific, if it is in accordance with how Hoppians describe it.
yeah, most of them have come to me and they basically describe, well, it's actually just a voluntary community and it doesn't have any of those problems. Then yeah, I don't think there'd be any problems there. I'm talking specifically about Hoppe's philosophy. When you talk about Hoppianism.
Okay. Well, is there anything else you wanted to talk about? Was there any subjects that you're interested in? Because I've been putting forward a few, and I was just wondering if there's anything that you wanted to discuss.
Yeah, you mentioned briefly earlier that the sustainability of a libertarian society, and I want to know exactly what your issues are with counter-economics, if you have any. Because that's my proposed means of achieving a libertarian society.
Okay, so explain to the audience roughly how the pursuit of agorism or the pursuit of counter-economics, that is, the pursuit of illegal economic activity, will deconstruct the state.
Well, not necessarily illegal economic activity, just anything that the fiat economy is not profiting off of, which, yes, while that generally involves black market activities, that you can also just make things, for
Okay.
instance, legally. But anyway, the reason why this will eventually innovate the state out of existence is because once the currency cap of the crypto economy increases in size, then investors will start making private businesses in the model of a trading in cryptocurrency, and trading in cryptocurrency will become much more mainstream. Now, the reason that states are so hostile to cryptocurrency and all of these corporatist businesses are so hostile to it is because it's decentralized. And
Right. It's a
just to put
competitor
that
to fiat currency.
Yeah, to put it into perspective, decentralization is not actually possible to regulate. For example, in the early 2000s, file sharing, a lot of companies in the state tried to come down on file sharing because people were pirating movies and music and stuff. Well, what pirators did is they created a decentralized means of file sharing, which most of you know as torrenting. Well, the state can't crack down on torrenting because it does not have a centralized point of distribution, and that's the reason why they just effectively gave up on it. And to cite a few actual examples, in the real world of the state trying to ban cryptocurrency, Russia and China both have a ban on cryptocurrency, and it did absolutely nothing to the crypto market. In fact, the crypto market grew.
Sorry, just so you know, like I am a supporter of cryptocurrency. Like I'm not
Oh
trying
yeah,
to go. Yeah,
I'm not saying you're against
of
it,
course,
but
of course.
generally, there are I assume, I don't know what camp you fall under, but I've heard you talk about the idea of a libertarian social order, so I assume that you're against agorism as a means of achieving a libertarian society.
Well, partially and partially not. Like, I support cryptocurrency, but I am an opponent of drug culture and drug use, and I don't support the people consuming and purchasing drugs as a means of competing with the state. So it depends what you mean. As a whole...
Well, I mean, you could also buy guns with it. I mean, it doesn't
yeah,
have to be
I support. Yeah, I mean, I support that, but in terms of cryptocurrency, I support it. I was going to buy in recently, but instead I invested in something else. And, yeah, so I can't give you, like, a single criticism of the whole position, because you would have to look at it on a market by market basis.
But essentially, it's not possible to actually regulate the currency, and since the currency is a competitor to fiat, what it will eventually do is it will outcompete fiat, and what will eventually happen when you have all these services being provided for by the crypto market, you'll start having these private security companies and schools. You'll have all of society's infrastructure being provided for with cryptocurrency, which, since it's actually profitable to trade in cryptocurrency, and it's a more valuable currency because it's actually it has a sustainable basis for its value, which is scarcity and utility, unlike fiat, which basically is just valuable because the state creates limited batches, but in reality it has no value. So what will eventually happen is, and that's essentially the reason why it's also the most effective strategy for establishing a libertarian society, because you don't have to be an agorist in order to exchange in it and see some benefit from doing so. You can be someone of any ideological persuasion, and it would benefit you to do this because you would be profiting directly from it. So, so eventually what would happen is you'd have this entire society, essentially the state just being a parasite off of the society. People would sit there and realize, hey, well, we could do all this without the state. The state is basically just a parasite on our income, so why don't we just stop paying taxes? So people would stop paying taxes. The state wouldn't have any money to send police or the military after people who stopped paying taxes. And even if they did, at this point, you would have all of these giant security companies to defend their customers from the state. So,
but you don't think people would be resistant to just become ideological ANCAPs and to not support the state? Wouldn't you think most people want to suppress immoral behavior that is deemed immoral in their eyes but isn't just strictly an act of violence, such as the before-mentioned drug use?
I think that some people would be opponents to it, but I'm talking about the general population, which doesn't ideologically lean strongly one way or the other. That's
because there a lot of these positions are actually predetermined by something that is very deep, something that is psychological, and something that is genetic, as it seems in a lot of cases, such as if you read Jonathan Haidt's work in psychology and his study, that's the most extensive study on political ideology and personality traits ever conducted, which has a sample size of 100,000, where it looks at different personality traits with people who identify as liberal, conservative, or libertarian. It seems that this opposition to the suppression of non-violent but nonetheless immoral behavior that libertarians have is determined by having an extremely low disgust scale, and that throughout the rest of mankind, people that aren't libertarian, they have an innate desire to police other people and to see non-violent behavior that they disagree with culled in a violent way, well, an organized violent way, such as through state policy.
I haven't read that study, but that wouldn't necessarily surprise me, but I don't understand exactly what you're saying.
It's also, well, I'm just trying to say that I don't think everyone would hop on this bandwagon of saying, well, the state, all they do is take our income. I think people actually like organized violence, and they feel organized violence civilizes them.
That's what I'm saying is that most of them would, and because most of them would, because most of the people don't fall into those that bandwagon of people who have deep psychological issues and want to violently suppress other people.
No, I'm not saying these are deep psychological issues. The propensity to feel disgust towards human activity is literally in the brain the exact same process of feeling disgust towards eating something that you don't like or smelling something that smells bad. They literally stem from the exact same process, and the disgust scale as a metric is something that is measured throughout all of humanity. The outliers are libertarians who don't have this high sense of disgust and have an extremely low one. And that when you feel disgust, it's not fear. It's not something that makes you want to get away with it. It's something that makes you want to burn it. That one of the biggest failures of liberal historians is to look at, say, somebody in history like Adolf Hitler and to say he was scared of the Jews. In reality, he was disgusted by the Jews because he wanted to burn them. He wanted to destroy them. And the reason why he had a propensity to act violently through his policies was because of the disgust scale that he had, which is something that is measured throughout everybody.
Well, I think that, yeah, that's possibly true, but I don't necessarily think that because someone is disgusted by something that they want to burn it.
No, that's just a metaphor, and we don't have to stick with disgust. We can look at all the other personality traits. Like, the biggest predictor of political liberalism is obviously agreeableness, but there's also, if you look at other personality traits that use a different model from the Big Five, which is also discussed in Haidt's study, for instance, fantasy, another big predictor of liberalism. These are things that would make you want to suppress people's ability to disassociate from groups that they don't like. That is an example of how they would want to violently suppress non-violent behavior that is still nonetheless immoral in their eyes, because they have high agreeableness. They don't think that people should be able to act disagreeable. They want to police disagreeableness, and they see disagreeable people perhaps as their competitors in many ways, and this is confirmed very much so in Haidt's work. So that's an example of somebody that is not conservative, because disgust is the biggest predictor of conservatism. That is an example of somebody that is not conservative and doesn't want to suppress non-conservative behavior, but in fact wants to suppress non-liberal behavior because they have the liberal trait of high agreeableness. So that's another example of how somebody would demand a state to suppress non-violent but nonetheless unethical behavior, and they are also predisposed to that through their personality, just like all of us.
Well,
all of our genes lead us to where we are. Sir?
It doesn't mean that they demand a state. It means necessarily they could possibly... that could be a driving force behind why people would actually form private communities. But
it's called Understanding Libertarian Morality. It's by Jonathan Haidt. But what I'm saying is that they want to, with the example of disgust, like with Adolf Hitler, he didn't want to just not be away from the Jews. He wanted them to suffer. And it's the same with disgust. When somebody acts in a way that you are disgusted by, you seek retribution. You don't just seek to deter yourself away from that person or to separate yourself from them. And it's the same with the way that liberals act towards like a Christian baker that does want to serve a gay person, even though that isn't an example of disgust scale. It's an example of high agreeableness, high fantasy, and so forth, and they see this person as a competitor. And there's other theories that explain this, like I think RK selection theory is still a good model to explain this, but they want punishment for this person. They don't just simply want them to associate within their own little community.
Well, the difference here now from former examples of individualist anarchism is that now, the great thing about agorism is that, well, I was going to explain, even if the state was funded, you have these private security firms, which, you know, are actually more innovative, they're more expansive, and they have better technology, but, the thing is now is that once the state's gone, this time, that's pretty much it. The state's gone. I mean, the reason it's gone to begin with is because we've decentralized the currency. So...
Okay, I have nothing against an anarchic society in principle. Like, if there's an anarchic society, I would probably even want to live there, to be honest. But I'm just saying that I'm not fully convinced, firstly, that this anarchic society could really sustain itself, but secondly, that you can suppress the demand for the state long enough to actually produce like an anarchic society. And firstly, it's for the reasons that I've just given. But secondly, historically, we're talking about the democratic state that we live in now, but democracy is the least natural mode of governance. Democracy only arises through violence and through revolution and through the expansion of democratic states that have already had these internal revolutions and then conquering other states and tearing down their mode of governance and replacing it with a democratic one. Historically, the most natural mode of governance is monarchic, and how monarchic governments form throughout all of human history is via the natural aristocracy. There are men that seek to transcend other men through great efforts and monopolize their skill, and often that skill might be Judas Prudence, or in the old world, the warrior would rise up and monopolize the legal system, and people would feel very comfortable being ruled by people that they see as transcendent to them. You know, this is like the idea of the God Emperor and so forth. And I just don't think historically people are resentful of the state all the time, or the idea of the state even.
Who's that? This again gets into my problem. How do they rule when the means of trade, everything has just been completely decentralized, and it's decentralized by its very nature?
So you're saying that people are using bitcoins and the government is incapable of coming and taking their bitcoins?
Yeah, well, at this point, we're talking about when agorism actually takes off. You have this giant decentralized market. Well, how?
I'm saying that that's a fair point to make. I'm not disagreeing with that. I am a supporter of cryptocurrency because it is a competitive fiat currency. But I'm just saying that if there is demand for something, then the market will provide it, and the state is no exception to this.
Yeah, and I can sort of understand what you're seeing, but that's the problem, is that the state necessarily requires a form of centralization to exist. It requires, you know, if people can trade anonymously, not only that, but they can do, but the only way they trade is anonymously, then how is it that a state can form?
Because the state building process can be first voluntary, and the aristocracy that comprise it can join voluntarily, and those that fund it can join voluntarily, and then the state building processes become state building through becoming involuntary, through expansion, as Tilly put forward, one of the necessary points of creating the state, and that would be an involuntary state making process.
They can fund it, but then the moment that it starts trying to expand, then, you know, what if everyone can just stop paying but
people have an interest in expansion and the appropriation of other people's resources.
Well, some people do, but
the bureaucracy, 50% of the population that comprise it.
I'm sorry, what was that?
Like, the state does, the bureaucracy has an interest, like 50% of the population is in the public sector, and they have an interest in appropriating other people's resources.
That's what I'm saying, though, is how do they do that?
I just gave you a way that they can do that. The state building process...
You gave me an example of how a state could form and how people could want a state, but what I'm saying
in a society where everything currency is Bitcoin.
Yeah, and it's decentralized, and it's decentralized by its nature. The moment that it becomes involuntary, then everyone will just stop funding it.
Yeah, but I'm saying that violence is seen as like a very useful tool historically in the eyes of most
people.
Yeah, like the people who might want to fund the state. Anyway, like, this conversation, I'm not, like, a fan of a lot of these conversations in anarchist communities because I just don't feel like they're that productive. Like, I'm not, in principle, opposed to an anarchist society. I'm kind of just more playing devil's advocate here. So if you want to talk about anything else, then that's fine. But would you want to end the discussion here?
Sure.
Yeah, thanks for coming to talk, man. I do appreciate it, because I know I kind of fired some shots at you across the bow in some of my videos, and I do appreciate you coming on. It's honorable.
Oh, no, it's fine.
Yeah, no hate or anything like that.
Oh, no, none at all.
Cool. So- well...